We are so proud of the lineup at this festival today, but I have to say the list of authors, a couple of whom are in the audience right now, who are speaking here at the Dashiell Hammett Pavilion, is stunning. If you were to really get really comfortable in your seats and just sit here all day, you'd see an amazing assortment of mystery writers. Indeed, some of the world's finest, winners of major awards, including the Pulitzer, perennial bestsellers, styles and genres, from the humorous to the historical to espionage to the classic. And it's that latter category that I'd put Thomas Kaufman's debut mystery, Drink the Tea. I picked up this book not knowing anything about the author or the story, and I really had a hard time putting it down. The book just hit that right spot. Drink the Tea, it's one of those really cool, gritty, jazzy, noirish stories in the tradition, I'd say the tradition of Raymond Chandler. It mostly takes place in D.C. with an understatedly multicultural cast of characters who roll us through some of the city's wealthiest neighborhoods and to some of its decaying, blighted, roughest patches. In the mystery genre, it's obviously a common thing to build a story around a private detective, but this one is really striking and unusual. He's actually a mystery within a mystery, and I'll let Thomas describe how that is. But he was striking enough, and the book was striking enough to win Kaufman the award of best first private eye novel from the Private Eye Writers of America. His follow-up, Steal the Show, is coming out in July, and I'm really looking forward to it. So, in addition to being an author, Thomas Kaufman is also a quite accomplished motion picture director and cameraman, having won an Emmy Award, among others, for his work on documentary films and other projects. This guy is a real talent, folks. We need to keep our eye on him. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming a really great up-and-comer, Thomas Kaufman.
Be hard to live up to that, I think. Thanks a lot. Appreciate that. The book was hard to put down because the publisher thought to epoxy the covers. It's a brilliant idea. You know, you're just stuck there. What can you do? You have to finish it. So thanks all for being here. This is really a wonderful day. It's really nice to be here in Gaithersburg. I do work as a cinematographer. Two of my cohorts are in the audience. These guys are sound recordists. And in our industry, we have a lot of jokes about sound recordists. They're kind of like our version of lawyers, I guess. So, for instance, how can you tell when a sound recordist dies? He drops his donut. Okay. Or what's the difference between a sound recordist and a coconut? Well, you can get a drink out of a coconut. Okay, so that's another one. Just supply your own rim shot there, if you would. Oh, sorry? I have to speak more into the microphone. Sorry, is that better for everybody, I hope? I hope it is, thanks, okay. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to read a little bit from this book, Drink the Tea, and then I'd like to answer some questions that you may have. But I'll tell you what it's like to be a writer, first of all. I want to say that it's not easy. The writer's life is a difficult life. My typical day, I get up at 6 a.m., and then breakfast by 6:15, and back in bed by 6:30. If I really get into the groove, I can make it back into bed around 6:23, 6:24. Then, you know, I get up again, it's around noontime, and the mail comes. And that's a very important milestone of my day. I can think about going to work as I sit down in front of the TV set for a while. So this is my typical writing day. That's writing in the house. Now, if I take my laptop computer outside of the house, I find that writing becomes much easier because I'm not surrounded by things that I have to do. I have all these distractions at home. So if I'm not in my home, I can write at a local coffee shop. That's a great place to write. Or the library is good. Once I took my son to a birthday party at Chuck E. Cheese, and I knocked out a chapter there. So I find that I can write just about anywhere except my own home. That's just something I'm working with. Now, my book, John was mentioning that there's a mystery within a mystery. And my private eye, Willis Gidney, grew up on the streets of Washington, D.C. without parents or a home. So when his best friend asked him to find a missing daughter, my private eye is really motivated to help him because he doesn't have any family of his own. The idea of getting a father and a daughter back together really appeals to him. And he takes the case, which turns out to be the biggest mistake he's ever made in his life. And so basically everything falls apart for him in the process of trying to find this daughter. So I'm going to read you a little bit from this book. And I could start at the beginning of the book, but that would make things a little bit too easy for all of us. So instead what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick it up, a few chapters in. My private eye, Gidney, is on Capitol Hill, and he is going into the Rayburn House office building. This is when we're picking up the story. Inside the Rayburn House office building, I stepped through the metal detector, then watched my phone glide across the grainy black and white TV screens, a fuzzy gray shape on a grayer background. It reminded me of the first time I had ever seen a security monitor. I was a kid inside a Metro Rail guard's kiosk. I don't have what you'd call a linear memory of childhood. Tiny pieces like flecks of light filtered through tree leaves, shifting, winking, on and off, so jumbled I couldn't tell you what was real and what I dreamed. Fragments of images, ghost sensations. I see myself in a baby's crib under a porch light at night. A woman, my mother, walks past me into the house. Why am I outside? Why doesn't she pick me up, take me in with her? Did it really happen? I have sense memories of a woman holding me, a dog barking, the smell of sulfur and snow falling. Another jump cut, and I'm older, on the streets of Washington, looking at the U.S. Capitol simmer in the heat and thinking it was a merry-go-round. As a kid, each day I spent on the street, I figured I was stealing, getting away with something. I had no idea to see what I was losing. You live on the street, the first thing you lose is your identity. If you're young, this happens fast. There are lots of reasons why. Number one is the people around you, men and women and boys and girls who've passed through society like phantoms through an alien dimension, existing only in a stranger's peripheral vision, filler for the paper's metro section. These folks are your peers, your friends, the village that's raising you, except it's not really a village, it's a pack. So you do what they do. This time I'm telling you about when I got busted wasn't the worst of it, not by a long shot, it's just the first time I got caught. And God is definitely part of my first true linear memory. He had some scam using a Xerox and $5 bill, slipping copies into the fare card machines of the metro. He knew the readers in those machines couldn't tell a copy from the real thing. God, a 10-year-old black kid whose full name was Godfrey White, had been my mentor for a month. I bunked with him beneath the Whitehurst Freeway in a cardboard box that once held a GE refrigerator, two-door, self-defrosting, ice maker included. With God's help, I knew I could stay out of Junior Village and Bachman's. I'd never been to either, but my mental image was if they caught me, I'd be chained to the wall and gnawed on by rats. Later, I found I wasn't far off the mark. Getting me into the Metro Guard's kiosk had been part of God's grand plan. I had paid attention while he explained how he would feed the Xerox copies of his $5 bill into the Metro fare card machine. The amount $5 would light up. Then God would tab the minus button until the fare showed 5 cents, jab another button, and down the chute would tumble $4.95 and change. Not a bad return on a 10-cent Xerox. The only trouble with God's fare card scam was that the bottom of the coin return was metal. All that change tumbling down made a racket. The Metro guard who sat in a nearby glassed-in booth might begin to suspect something, particularly if you heard that kind of sound 10 times in a row. God figured that $49.50 was all the change he could carry away in his paper sack. My job? Distract the guard. How? I asked. Cry and tell him you're lost, God said. I was a despicable little brat and took to my role with gusto. I played the little lost boy with an intensity that would have expelled me from the most amateur play. I was too young to know better. I thought I was great. I cried, mommy, daddy, as I approached the Metro guard and he recoiled exquisitely. I was incoherent with fear and pain and hopes he would open the door to the booth and I could get inside. He didn't want to leave his booth. He tried speaking to me through his little microphone. I wasn't having that. I cried harder. My pale little face beat red, the tears streaming down. Real tears. Yeah, I was playing an abandoned kid. Method acting. I beat my little fists against the window to block out the sound of the change gushing down the chute. God told me I get half the take and that was all the motivation I needed. Finally, the guard, a kindly-looking white guy with a salt-and-pepper goatee, opened the door. I practically fell inside. I hugged his knees and cried, my voice bouncing off the glass walls of the booth. So far, God had used 4 of his copies. What's the matter, boy? The guard asked. I wailed even louder, my ear-splitting voice reverberating off the glass walls. It was even giving me a headache. Did you lose your mommy and daddy? My mouth opened. I screamed and nodded. Outside, a steady stream of change clanged. Where'd you lose him? I heard another crash of coins, that would be 8, and took a breath. The guard thought he was calming me, but really I was building towards my big finish. In heartrending sobs, I said that the subway doors had closed behind my parents and the train had pulled away without me. Which way was the train going? I'll call ahead, the guard said. Not here, I sobbed. Downtown. The stutter was a nice touch. Meanwhile, God had finished and, hefting his swag, staggered toward the exit. I held up my hands to the guard. I said I was all right now. I'd find my folks. Don't worry. I figured he'd be glad to get rid of me. I was wrong. He started to come after me, his hand out, a solicitous expression on his face. I backed away, realizing I might have overplayed my part just a tiny bit. I retreated into something and fell, and there was a crash, and God's bag of coins hit the tile floor, and coins were bouncing off the floor like water drops on a red-hot skillet. The last time I saw God, he was hot-footing it out of there as the Metro guard grabbed my arm, his fingers tight. I can still feel his fingers there. So that's just a little section from near the beginning part of Drink the Tea. Thanks. Thank you. Yes, I think I was swimming laps in the pool when I wrote that one. So one of the things that Judd had mentioned is that I work as a motion picture cameraman. And so this helps me in lots of ways. First of all, we shoot interviews with people about all sorts of subjects. This past week, I was working on a film about the Enlightenment for Chinese TV. So approximately 100 million Chinese people are going to see a film about the Enlightenment that's being made by a company in England and co-produced by French and German TV. Will it ever make the United States? I don't know. But it was very interesting filming at Monticello, learning about the Enlightenment. You know, for me around my house, that's when I changed the light bulb. That's what that happens. So it was nice to know there was a different side to it. But also, as a cameraman, I look at things through a viewfinder. And so when I write scenes, like the one that I just read to you, I'm trying to visualize the scene. I'm trying to see what would it look like if I were watching it happen. And so I think that that's the kind of book that I like to read does that. And it helps me be a cameraman because that's what I'm seeing every day that I'm out there working. And then days where I'm not out filming something, those are days that I'm home writing. The other thing is that I've done a lot of shows about cops for Discovery Channel and National Geographic. And so I think a lot of policemen are great storytellers, maybe natural storytellers. And so hanging out with these guys has been wonderful. And they've been very generous with their time and talking to me about things that they've seen around this area. So the film work has also exposed me to a lot of cops. I've made relationships and kept up with them. And also a lot of great stories. So all this stuff is grist for the mill. It sort of percolates in. And I guess the only other thing that I would talk about is that we're in the Dashiell Hammett Pavilion. Does everyone here know that Dashiell Hammett was born in Baltimore? He's of Maryland? Son of Maryland? No? Okay. And that Edgar Allan Poe tent is over there. And Poe also was born in Maryland. I think also born in Baltimore. And what I think is so interesting, having them side by side, is that Edgar Allan Poe was the first person to write a private eye story. It's an American invention. We came up with the private eye story. And it was called The Murders of the Rue Morgue. And I think it was 1864, thereabouts, that he wrote it. So another American invention is jazz music. And as we know, as Judd was mentioning, there's a lot about jazz music in this book. And jazz music is also an American invention. And there's an element of improvisation in jazz music, where the person who's taking a solo doesn't know exactly what he's going to play until the moment he stands there and starts playing it. There's kind of a parallel in writing the private eye story, because not only are they both American inventions, but a lot of people write without an outline. And one of the questions that people ask me a lot is, do you use an outline when you write? And the answer is, nah. I mean, sometimes I like to have an idea where I'm going when I'm writing, but I don't have an exact step-by-step guide map of how to get there. So I can sort of, the analogy of driving a car, I can sort of see on the horizon where it is I want to get to, but I don't really know what route I'm going to take to get there when I'm starting the trip. But I do know where I want to wind up. So that's as much of an outline as I get, and the rest is improvisation. One of my favorite writers is a guy named Lawrence Block, and he said, if I don't know what's going to happen next in the story as the writer, chances are the reader isn't going to know what's going to happen next either. And so I think that's a good way to approach it. And also, I've read so many private eye novels, you know, that in a way I've unconsciously programmed myself to think a certain way. I mean, if you read a lot of a certain kind of book, chances are you already know a lot about how to write that kind of book. And the rest of it is just sticking your tush down on the chair, you know, and typing away for a certain number of hours a day. So that's one of the things that I've learned, you know, through doing this. And it's really, really fun, really interesting. I think the best part of it is getting to meet the readers. And that's really fun. A lot of writers, there are writers in the audience now. There's Alan Orloff and Brad Parks, excellent writers. And we all have websites where you can contact us because, you know, yeah, sure, it's promotion. We want to sell books. But also, as writers, it's genuinely fun to talk to the reader who's read the book because it's like making a movie. You know, you want to know what people think about it. I mean, you know what you think about it, but it'd be nice to know what someone else thinks about it, too. So it's great to be invited here today. It's so beautiful out. And I want to say thanks for everyone that's coming and also see if anyone has any questions about what it's like to raise Dobermans. I don't really know anything about that subject, but maybe someone else in the audience does. Or if you want to talk about mysteries or writing Drink the Tea or Steal the Show. I didn't mention Steal the Show. It's the second book in the series. It's coming out July 5th. But I'm not allowed to sell that one yet. I can only sell this one today. So you can read the first one. If you like it, you can read the second one. So does anyone have any questions? Yes, Mr. Parks.
When raising Dobermans, Yukonuba or Iams?
No. Well, Yukonuba if you want to. I am just standing here.
I'm curious, though. Okay, you've got this character who does have this very different past, so I'm going to make this personal comment.
All right.
Did you have a shattered childhood?
Yes. The question is, did I have a shattered childhood? Oh, boy, did I. I grew up in a middle-class family in Cleveland Heights, Ohio, and I went to school every day, and my parents were there every night. It was dreadful. I don't know how I survived it or turned out as well as I did. But you know, you bring up a point about the private eye. You know, a lot of, I love private eye novels, and a lot of them, like Raymond Chandler, just, you know, I think are fantastic. But as much as I love Raymond Chandler and Robert B. Parker, I knew I couldn't write that novel because they had already done that. I had to do something else. So I wanted to make my private eye a little bit different, and hopefully, you know, interesting to the reader. So this private eye doesn't really know much about his own background. He doesn't really have any linear memories of his own childhood. And so, you know, Willis Gidney is not the name he's born with, but he's the name that he's given. So I think that writing about this kind of guy made for an interesting character because there's a lot of inherent conflict in that. It's just like writing about Washington, D.C. You know, Chandler used Los Angeles as a character in one of his books, and I think when a book has got a really great setting, that setting comes alive in the mind of the reader. You might think about it after you've finished reading the book or while you're reading the book. And Washington, D.C., to me, is that kind of city. It's almost like two cities that are grafted one on top of the other. There's the seat of federal government, and then there's the city where people live and work and pay taxes and sweat. And, you know, there's not a lot of points of intersection, and yet they're living, you know, right on top of one another, as it were. So I think that Washington, D.C. is a great place to write it out because it also has that inherent conflict. And then my guy's gone through all these institutions. Gidney's been institutionalized in kiddie jails in D.C. and Maryland. So he has an inherent mistrust of authority. He finds it very hard to get along with certain types of people. He often is not successful at things that he's tried to do. He's dropped out of college. He was only a cop for a year. So, you know, I think my protagonist is a great guy, but let's face it, he's got a few issues. And so I also like books that are funny, that have interesting characters, and so that's what I've tried to do with Drink the Tea. Dr. Parks, thank you very much for that question. And I see there's another hand somewhere in the audience. In back there, perhaps, or no? It was your dog. Was you're scratching your head? Thank you very much. I thought your dog was going to ask me a question. Do I know any other sound man jokes? Says only a sound man would ask me this question. Well, you know, what did Jesus Christ say to a group of sound men at the Last Supper? Don't do anything till I get back. I can transpose it from Teamsters to sound men if I want to. Yeah, there are a lot of Teamster jokes too, but we're not even gonna go there. Yeah, the second book, this first book, by the way, deals with corruption in Congress, which was amazing because it seems like whenever I write these books, it actually happens. So I was writing about this corrupt congressman who was laundering money to fund his own political ambitions, and up comes a long time delay. And I was like, boy, this is so rude. I thought of this before you did. How dare you do this? So, you know, one only can wonder if something like that will happen in Steal the Show, where Gidney is tasked with protecting a movie from being stolen by film pirates. The film business loses about $2 billion a year, you know, when it's not because of bad sound. They lose money because people steal films and distribute them on a black market. often when the film comes out, and sometimes even before the film comes out, $2 billion a year. So there's a director in Hollywood and a lobbyist in Washington who have an idea for protecting films by sending them through a special digital encryption satellite signal from L.A. to the Uptown Theater as a demonstration. And so Gidney's job is to make sure that that goes off okay. So that's what Steal the Show is about. All right, so I don't know if anyone has any other questions. Yes, sir.
I was initially introduced to the private eye genre through film and television.
Okay.
And then from looking back, Sherlock Holmes was made in the film in the teens, and then all the way through Sam Spade, Mike Hammer, to the TV shows in the 70s. Are there any up and coming or ones that I'm missing that are on film or television today?
Oh. All right, the question was about private eyes in film and TV. There's been a long history of great private eye films in both media. So are there anything up and coming? Guys, do you know anything up and coming that we could talk about? I don't. I know that some books have been sold, but that doesn't mean they're going to be made. Keith Thompson wrote a great spy thriller called Once a Spy, the rights to which were sold. Whether it gets made into a film or not, I couldn't say. Marcus Sakey is a great Chicago suspense writer. He wrote a book, I think, Good People, I think, got optioned. So these films, they'll buy the rights either outright or for a limited time to make a movie. But great private eye movies, however, there's a lot of them.
There's so many.
Yeah.
I mean, they remade them. Like I say,
Sherlock Holmes, Mike Hammer, right. But there's certain private eye movies, though, that if you haven't seen, you must see. And one of them would be Out of the Past with Robert Mitchum and Kirk Douglas. This is one of the great private eye movies of all time, directed on a shoestring budget at RKO Studios, and a wonderful, wonderful film. So Out of the Past, I'd say, was one of the great private eye films of all time. The Big Sleep with Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall, directed by Howard Hawks, also one of the great, great films of all time. You know, what's interesting, too, is the way that private eye films handle violence, in fact, the way all films handle violence, to me as a filmmaker, is something that's very interesting because you've got different styles. For instance, there's the Bonnie and Clyde style, which is slow motion ballet as you're getting hit, and they've got thousands of squibs, little exploding dye packets, They spend hours. On the shot where someone gets shot up, there are hours and hours of work going into rigging all of that. And I heard with Bonnie and Clyde when they shot Warren Beatty the first time, he was grinning. For some reason, the absurdity of what was going on just really struck him. And there's this footage. I would love to see this shot because they're rolling 35-millimeter cameras at 120 frames a second in slow motion. And you see his body going back and forth. And he's just got this big grin on his face. So that's the slow motion ballet type of death. And then there's Howard Hawks' Big Sleep, where violence happens so quickly that you can't prepare for it. And that's what's so awful about violence. And I think, the Howard Hawks method is a lot better than the slow motion ballet Sam Peckinpah type of stuff. So those are some of the great private eye. Of course, on TV, Joe Mantegna was playing a Spencer for a while. They were making a Spencer movies with Joe Mantegna, and that was great. And I like the new Sherlock Holmes movie, although it's not really, I think it got the spirit, although it changed absolutely everything about it. It was fun to watch. Are there any other questions? Yes. I have a theory about that. The question, right, L.A. and New York, perfect places for private eye stories, but Washington, D.C., how come? And if you look at it historically, the Washington, D.C. private eye novels began right about the time that the movie The Day the Earth Stood Still came out. And my theory is that when that spaceship landed on the Washington Mall, it sent out a kind of ray for children who were being born right around the mid-50s, right? And that we all kind of evolved into these private eye writers, and that's why there's so many in Washington today. It's alien intervention once again. Yes. Oh, yes, there's a question back there.
You mentioned Lawrence Block earlier. Aren't you glad he squeezed out one more Scudder?
Yeah, the question is, am I glad that Lawrence Block has done a new Matthew Scudder novel? Yeah, I mean, it's just like, it's the best thing in the world. Donald Westlake is also one of my favorite writers, and he passed away about 2 years ago, and a contemporary of Lawrence Block. And Lawrence Block finished Westlake's last manuscript called Memory. Yeah, so I'm very glad. The Matthew Scudder series by Lawrence Block is a great, great series to read. And also his lighter fare with Bernie Rodenbart as a gentleman burglar is also quite good. Yeah, a lot of Lawrence Block's films and Donald Westlake's films were made into movies of, you know, questioning. Casting in these movies is always fun, too. It's the question I get asked a lot is, who would I cast as Willis Gidney? And I never answer that question. But the casting of John Dortmunder in the Dortmunder novels has always been a source of, you know, amusement to me. Like, Dortmunder's a guy who looks like he's been standing under a steady drip of water all day. You know, I think Christopher Lloyd when I think John Dortmunder. And here they've cast Robert Redford as the first John Dortmunder. And Donald Westlake said, really? Redford? Huh? Oh, okay. So, yeah. Yes. That's a good question. When you're doing a series, how do you keep the character alive and that personality alive? And I think it's part of a process of discovery. When you're writing about a person, a character that you've created for the first time, you may not know that person very well. And then when you write a second draft of that book and you've had time to let that person sort of seep in a little bit, you're going to know that they're going to react to things differently than you will. And maybe the third or fourth draft, that character's reactions and how they're going to respond to certain things is going to be more ingrained. And so as you get to know someone, it becomes much more interesting as a writer to write about that person because they're different, but they're different in a way that's understandable. And I think the key to it is understanding. We, you know, it's not just that people do things. We want to know, why are they doing them? We want some information about the human condition, you know, why it happens. And so it's fun to discover that in a character that you've created, basically. And that's one of the things that keeps me going. Plus, I just like doing it. Yeah. It's interesting, too, you know, about good guys and bad guys in writing, because recently the high school where my kids go put on Macbeth, and my son and I are watching the play, and he leans over to me, he's 14, he leans over to me and he says, is Macbeth the good guy? And I said, wow, that's a really interesting question. Is Macbeth the good guy? And I said, well, he's the protagonist. He's the one the play is about, you know. He's doing all the wrong things, but Shakespeare is going to a lot of trouble to explain why Macbeth is doing it and what happens to him as a result. So, you know, in this kind of situation, you know, Macbeth really is the hero, and the forces of right are the forces of antagonism for Macbeth. So it was a very interesting thing. I saw an interview with Lee Marvin, who was a great character actor, and also we talked about great film noir movies. There's also The Big Heat. It's a Fritz Lang movie with Lee Marvin and Glenn Ford. And so towards the end of his career, they interviewed Lee Marvin, and they said, it must have been hard for you playing bad guys all the time in your career. And Lee Marvin said, I never played any bad guys. And the interviewer said, you didn't? And Marvin said, no, I just played regular guys that were doing what they had to do to make it to the end of their day. You know, just guys trying to get along. That's all. And then I was thinking, well, this, of course, is right. You know, a villain doesn't look at themselves as, you know, a mustache twirling up to some evil today. The villain's out there to right some kind of wrong, to restore some kind of imbalance. They've got their own agenda. And, you know, when you're writing it, you want it to be opposed to what your hero's agenda is. But they've got their reasons for doing it. And so that's also fun to do when you're writing these kinds of books, is think about the bad guys. They never have a wife. Why don't they ever have a wife? Well, they could, and they sometimes do. There's a great private eye writer in Brooklyn named Reed Farrell Coleman. Reed Farrell Coleman has written maybe 7 or 8 books about a Jewish private eye in Brooklyn that are fantastic. And he's married and has a child. So sometimes they do get married. Yeah. But I think without being married, you know, it's really interesting. I'm about to say this. I'm a married guy and I'm saying this. If your character is unmarried, you have more room to move in terms of conflict and what's going on between you and the other character. And there's more, it can be broken off more easily, I think. So there's more in the balance that way. But when you're married, I think that, you know, because of the social contract, that's less likely, not impossible. But then you really have to ramp it up if they're talking about a divorce or a separation. It's got to, you know. But, you know, maybe for other people that would be interesting to read about. I don't know. I never thought about that. I just know in Get Smart, when they got married in Get Smart, the whole series went downhill for me. So, okay, well, I think, am I reaching the end of my rope here? Yeah, kind of, sort of. Maybe one or two more questions, if one or two more people want to ask a question. But if not, I'd like to thank everyone for being here. It's really been great. Thank you so much.